So I hope you're looking forward to Thanksgiving. Anyone looking forward to Thanksgiving? You know, for us, it's one of my favorite holidays. It is my favorite holiday. And in fact, it's not something we grew up celebrating in South Africa. We never celebrated Thanksgiving, partly because we didn't have pilgrims that came over and, you know, things were done a little differently. But Debbie and I have been able to celebrate 23 years of Thanksgivings here in America, and it is always good because we have a little bit of an understanding of what they went through, because when we came to America 23 years ago, we had nothing. And the people that in our community in Georgia blessed us and cared for us and provided for us and helped us navigate some of the things, and we got to receive some financial gifts as well, just to help us over some of the challenges that we had. And you know, we have much to be thankful for, Debbie and I. And we've had a challenging year with medical issues and so on, but we still have much to be thankful for. And one of the things I'm really, really thankful for and blessed is this church family. You know, we started attending here 11 years ago, and one thing has stood out and has never changed. When we were just attendees and we were guests, and now as the pastor, we are still loved and cared for, and we want to say thank you. We love you all, and we thank you for your love for us and your prayers for us. So we appreciate all of you very, very much. You know, a number of years ago, I read a book that really challenged me, and the challenge of the book was regarding experience joy in life, true joy in life. The author was saying, you know, that the true joy in life can only come from a grateful heart. It can only come once you have true gratitude can you experience true joy. And a grateful spirit can prevent you from feeling sorry for yourself, can prevent you from getting depressed. And he says this: the seeds of depression cannot take root in a grateful heart. The seeds of depression cannot take root in a grateful heart. You know, sometimes we complain about the things that we should actually be grateful for. So, for example, you know, we complain about the mess in the kitchen, we complain about all the dishes that we have to do, and well, we have to be thankful for the fact that we actually were able to have people around the table and enjoy a meal together, to be able to gather together as a family. You know, we complain about household chores and fixing things around the house and mopping the floors and mowing the lawn, but we really should be grateful that we have a home. We have a place that we can call home. We sometimes complain about our aching joints and our joint pains and the struggles that we have in life. And after some hard day's work, we complain that everything hurts. But the fact is, we could do a hard day's work. That's something to be thankful for, that we actually have a body that is able to work enough to get painful. That's something to be thankful for. You know, we need to learn to be thankful for the situations and the challenges in life, just as much as we need to be thankful for the things that are really good in life. You know, God is using those challenges, He's using those things, not just to make us stronger, but to grow us in our love for Him, to grow us in our faith. And God will use them for His glory. So we're going to come back to that in a moment. But when we really think about it, we've got a lot to be thankful for. I would like you to challenge you to do this exercise. What if you were to take this afternoon and put the remote down, turn the TV off, and begin writing down a list of things to be thankful for? And I'm sure if you really worked at it, maybe not even too difficult, without too much difficulty, you could come up with 100 things to be thankful for. And it's a really good exercise, because it will lead you to change your perspective of the problems in life. It'll change your perspective of those things that are really nagging and bothering you when you begin to really focus on the blessings that God has given you. You know, this past summer, we were able to go to South Africa, and once again, I was challenged by the children. And I've been to some of the poorest parts of the world, and many of you have as well on different mission trips, and seen the children in very poor and impoverished parts of the world. They're some of the happiest people you would ever meet. They have nothing, but they're some of the happiest people you'll ever meet. In South Africa, the children make little cars out of wire and tin cans, and they play with these things in the sand. Well, they take an old tire, and they'll get two sticks, and they'll put the two sticks inside the tire and run along with it and drive this tire as if it was their car. And they're doing it with such joy. They have a perspective that we don't have. We have much to learn about true joy. We have much to learn about gratitude. You know, Rudyard Kipling, he was a well-known writer around the early 1900s. And Kipling was one of the few writers that actually was fortunate enough to make a lot of money while he was still alive. And one of the reporters who was interviewing him had said, you know, we've figured out, and he was in America at the time, and this reporter said, there's been some research done into you, Mr. Kipling, and we found out that every word you write makes $100. That's how much money you're making off the things that you write. So every word that you make, or every word that you write makes $100. So the reporter pulled out a $100 bill very cynically and gave it to him and said, now I want a $100 word. I want you to give me a $100 word. And so Rudyard Kipling took the $100 bill and he neatly folded it, put it in his pocket, and said, thanks. He said one word, thanks. But isn't that true that thanks is a $100 word? In fact, it's probably $1 million word. It's something, it's a word that we don't use often enough to thank the people sometimes who get no gratitude and no thanks. Our society would be so different if we really were walking in gratitude. Now, I'm not saying you don't thank people around you. I know many of you do. But what if we all appreciated and then said that we appreciate what people are doing for us? You know, in our society, Thanksgiving is it's kind of an interfaith holiday. And for many people, it's a faith optional holiday. But the roots of Thanksgiving are based in giving thanks to the one true God. The roots of Thanksgiving, we know, was originally a 3-day holiday. And it was to thank God for his provision and his protection. You know, the early pilgrims suffered much back in 1620 to 1623, thereabouts, and nearly half of those who came on the Mayflower died. And yet, Edward Winslow writes in his journal around that first Thanksgiving, and he says, by the goodness of God, we are far from want. We're far from want. You know, the original Thanksgiving proclamation, I know there's been numerous over the years, but Governor William Bradford of the Plymouth Colony, and in his proclamation, he mentions God 4 times, giving thanks to God. And that was in 1623. And to this year, that's 400 years. I believe it's a quadricentennial. I had to look that up. 400 years today, or this year. But you know, Thanksgiving is all about God. It is all about Him. We have to understand that if without God, we've got no one to give thanks to. Dante Rossetti, the poet and artist in the 19th century, he says, the worst moment for an atheist is when he is really thankful and has no one to thank. How can we celebrate this holiday if we don't acknowledge the fact that we have a creator God, and He is the provider, and He has given us much and blessed us with much. You know, true gratitude is directed at God. As James wrote in James 1:17, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. You know, the book of Psalms is a really good place to go to focus on, to think about, to give us language for thanksgiving, to give us language to help us to thank God and appreciate God for what he has done for us. You know, the Psalms were written by people, obviously mostly David, but written by people who went through troubles and trials just like us. They went through difficult times and seasons just like us. But time and time again, as you read the Psalms, I don't know if you've noticed it, you read the Psalms, the beginning few verses of a Psalm is filled with trials, challenges, and unexpected problems, almost insurmountable problems. But then the psalmist will focus and change his view and begin to look at God, begin to worship God, begin to focus on the power of God, the majesty of God. And then the rest of the psalm is praising God and thanking God for even for the victory that they haven't yet seen. Today I want to look briefly at Psalm 105, which is attributed to David. And we're just going to look at the first seven verses. But in fact, the first 15 verses of Psalm 105 were actually written by David on the occasion that the Ark of the Covenant was brought back into Jerusalem. When you read about it in 1 Chronicles 15 and 16, where King David danced before the Lord and all the people with all his might. He worshiped God and gave thanks to God because the Ark of the Covenant was coming back into Jerusalem to its rightful place. And David gathered all the people of Israel, and he gave each one a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins. They actually had a Thanksgiving celebration there. So 1623 wasn't the first Thanksgiving celebration, but it was right around thousands of years ago in Jerusalem, as King David said, "We are going to thank the Lord, and we're going to feast together." So Psalm 105, just looking at the first seven verses. Turn with me in your Bibles. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. O offspring of Abraham, his servants, children of Jacob, his chosen ones, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. You know, the psalm begins with that line, oh, give thanks to the Lord. And then verse 2, sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works. And the Hebrew word used here for thanks is yada, which actually is a verb that which declares more about simply receiving something from God, but it's declaring thankfulness for his attributes. It's a thanksgiving because of who God is, more than simply for what we get from God. The psalmist is not simply thankful for the blessings, but he is thankful for the attributes of God. He's thankful for the giver himself. You know, spending time giving thanks should always lead to worship. But verse 1 and 2 show us something else that flows out of thankfulness. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of his wondrous works. You see, as we are thankful for God, we're thankful for what we have received from God, we're thankful for his attributes, we praise him and we make his name known. We give glory to God and we tell of what he has done to the people around us. We tell of his wonderful acts. You see, if we're thankful to God, we will be compelled to tell others what he has done for us. A heart for missions is always driven by a heart of gratitude. It has to come from that place of, look what God has done, and let me tell you what God has done for me. Reading further in the next two verses in Psalm 105, we see that the psalmist changes his focus from what God has done to worshiping God himself. Again, thanksgiving leads to worship. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. The name of God. The name of God is the culmination of all of his attributes. It's who God is. And we, as his children, we can become so focused on our needs and the things that we need from God that we forget to focus on who God is and worship him. As we seek the face of God, we see his attributes. We see his love, his mercy, his omnipotence, his glory, his justice, his grace. You know, we could go on listing the attributes of God forever. You know, a few weeks ago, we had a time of prayer here in the church service where I said, let's just list the attributes of God. And you know, it's amazing how quickly we run out in that time of prayer. But the attributes of God are never ending. We just don't know them all. And as we begin to seek his face, as we begin to know him, we begin to see more of his attributes and we give him glory. So in order to be truly thankful, we need to meditate on the nature and the character of God, who he is. Do we thank God for his benefits or do we thank God for who he is? Do we thank God that he is just and kind? Do we thank God that he is merciful and unchanging? Even though being grateful for the benefits of knowing God is proper, it's the right thing to do. It's only part of what we must be. Excuse me. You know, excuse me. But it's the right thing to do to be grateful for the benefits of the things that God has given us. But true gratitude must be rooted in the glory of God, must be rooted in the excellency and the character of God. True gratitude must be rooted in who God is. When we only focus on the blessings of God, we are like a child who gets a gift from a parent and then takes that gift and uses it in a way that would dishonor the parent. Do we focus on what we can get from God? You know, James wrote very directly about this in James 4:3. You ask and you do not receive, because you ask wrongly to spend it on your own passions. You know, Jonathan Edwards once said, God is not glorified if the foundation of our gratitude is the worth of the gift and not the excellency of the giver. If the gratitude is not rooted in the beauty of God before the gift, it's probably disguised idolatry. May God grant us a heart to delight in him for who he is, so that all our gratitude for his gifts will be the echo of our joy in the excellency of the giver. Let's focus on the giver, the excellencies of who God is this Thanksgiving. It's a wonderful time to praise, to remember the hand of God. Yes, we remember the hand of God, but let's focus on the face of God and on his glory. You know, God is not a cosmic vending machine that we just go to when we have a need. He has made a way through the death and resurrection of his son that we can enter into relationship with him. We can know him and make him known, to have a close relationship with him. That's why the psalmist encourages us to seek the Lord, to seek him, to know him, to grow in relationship with him, more than simply getting things from him. Well, then verse 5 continues, remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. You know, the word that the psalmist uses here for remember is not simply a recollection of the facts. You know, I have a really challenging time remembering facts and things that happened. But what he's saying is not simply recommend or recollect the facts, but is also to call to mind the wonders of who God is and what he has done, and then to dwell on them It's not simply saying, oh, well, thanks for all those things. It's to dwell on them, to meditate on them, to spend some time meditating and dwelling on what God has done, to slow down, to hit the pause button in life, and to thank God. You know, much like a day of Thanksgiving, when we stop everything, we slow down, we put the phone down, hopefully put the TV remote down, and we meditate on the miracles that God has done. You know, our culture really struggles with this, doesn't it? Our culture is so entertainment-driven and so busy that if you take a phone away from somebody today, it's like you cut off their right arm. They're unable to function without having that. But I want to challenge you on Thanksgiving Day just to put it all down and to focus on God and what He has done for us. Then verse 6, it seems that he's stating the obvious by telling the Israelites who they are. O offspring of Abraham, his servants, children of Jacob, his chosen ones. In essence, he's saying, do you remember who you are? Do you remember who you are? This God of all creation has chosen you. He has chosen you. If that's not sufficient cause to be thankful, you're chosen by God, and we are included in that. We get to be included in that. We as followers of Jesus Christ are His chosen ones. We sometimes forget who we are. We have much to be thankful for. The Creator of the universe calls us His own. 1 Peter 2 verse 9, you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for His own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. That's a verse for Thanksgiving. You are God's special possession. And then verse 7 continues, He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. You know, the God who calls us His special possession, His chosen children, is also the same God that is over all the earth, holding all things together, as the Word says. His ways are perfect. There's nothing outside of His sight. There's nothing outside of His control. And He is our Heavenly Father. So we see the progression here. The psalm begins with thankfulness for God for His blessings. And then he progresses to worshiping God for who He is. And then ultimately, as we begin to thank God for His blessings on our lives, we're naturally drawn to that greatest gift of all. The greatest gift of all is what God has given us when He sent His only Son to die on the cross for our sins. There is nothing more that we need to be thankful for than the gospel message, what He has given to us. Sometimes we say the gospel, we speak about the gospel, in a few weeks we're going to celebrate Christmas, but do we really know and celebrate with thanksgiving what God has given us in sending His only Son to be the way for us to enter into a relationship with God? Jesus didn't simply come as a baby. He came with a purpose, and that purpose included suffering on a cross, bearing the shame, bearing the agony, and bearing the weight of the sins of the world. But we serve a risen Lord Jesus today. Praise the Lord. And because of Jesus Christ, we will have eternal life. And we will be eternally grateful for what God has done for us. So that's why we are thankful. That's the celebration of Thanksgiving. But what if you're suffering today? What if you're going through hardships and challenges today? Maybe you're going through financial hardships. Maybe you're going through financial trials, maybe you're going through physical trials, sickness, illness, maybe emotional struggles or relationship struggles. Maybe you're experiencing the loss of a loved one or experiencing a broken relationship. How do you thank God in the tough times? How do we thank God when it seems like we've lost so much or we're struggling with so much? You know, George Matheson, He was a well-known Scottish preacher around the 1800s, and he suffered terribly from poor eyesight. And in fact, his eyesight deteriorated at a young age. By the time he had graduated from seminary, he was completely blind. And at the same time, his fiancée, that they had had this life plan together, when he became blind, she left him. But the people that he served, he continued to be a preacher, and he became a hymn writer. But the people that he served and the people that were in his church, many of them had no idea that he was so restricted in his eyesight and even blind. They had no idea, because he carried himself so well. He carried himself with such joy and thankfulness all the time. There was somebody that wrote his biography that said he was blind, but he could see better than all of us, because he could see God. He could see what God has done in his life. He's also a famous hymn writer. He wrote the hymn, "O Love That Wilt Not Let Me Go." Some of you may know that one. The third stanza reads, "O joy that seekest me through pain, I cannot close my heart to thee. I trace the rainbow through the rain and feel the promise is not vain, that morn shall tearless be." He was a man who suffered more than the loss of his eyesight. He suffered as a loss of relationships, in his dreams and the things that he wanted out of life. He suffered a lot. But he once wrote the following in response to his sufferings. He said, "My God, I have never thanked thee for my thorn. I have thanked thee 1,000 times for my roses, but never once for my thorn. I've been looking forward to a world where I shall get compensation for my cross. Teach me the value of my thorn. Show me that I have climbed to thee by the path of pain. Show me that my tears have made my rainbow." What a perspective. What thorn do you have in your life today? What is that thorn that you're carrying today? Are you able to thank God for the thorn? You know what? That takes faith. That takes an eternal perspective. That takes saying, even though I'm experiencing the pain of this thorn, I see it in perspective of all of eternity. That God is good, and that what he's doing is he's working it out for my good and for his glory. That's how we're able to look at the thorn and say, he is making a rainbow out of my tears. If we as believers are grateful for the suffering that Jesus went through on the cross, and we are, we're grateful for what Jesus has done for us, then we need to learn to be thankful and grateful for the suffering he allows us to go through. Because it's in that suffering that other people around us will see us and begin to ask the question, what is it about them that they're able to have joy in the midst of pain? And point them to Jesus. Point them to the cross. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 to 18 says, "Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." So many people keep on asking the question, what is God's will for me? What is God's will for me? I need to know what's God's plan for me. His will is for us to give thanks in all circumstances. Sometimes it takes the power of the Holy Spirit for us to be able to give thanks in all circumstances. So as we close today, maybe you need God's perspective on your thorn, the perspective on the pain that you're going through, those trials that you're going through. Maybe you need God to reveal to you what he is doing, and he might not reveal that to you this side of eternity. But maybe you need some prayer, some comfort for that. Because you're going into Thanksgiving and saying, yeah, I know I'm supposed to be grateful. I'm supposed to be thankful, but I'm really struggling right now. I'm really hurting right now. I want to invite you as we close, our prayer team will be up here up front just to take advantage of someone to pray for you today. But as we close, I want us to, as a church body, just to spend a few moments declaring our gratitude to God. So let's just all close our eyes And as the worship team comes up, let's just close our eyes, and I want you to pray out your little heart of little prayers of gratitude to God for what He has done for you. And maybe you can even give thanks for the thorn in your life. So let's just do that just for a few moments, and then I'll close in prayer. Lord, we're grateful today for your many blessings. I pray, Lord, that today you will touch those of us who are hurting, struggling with pain, struggling with sadness, loss. Lord, teach us to praise you through the pain. Teach us to thank you and trust you. Lord, give us an eternal perspective. Lord, thank you that your word says in Psalm 34 that you are near to the brokenhearted. May you touch lives in this place today with your nearness. We thank you, Lord. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.